Krishnadas Music presents Yoga of Devotion Retreat with Krishnadas at Sachidananda Ashram Yogaville in Buckingham, Virginia. Memorial Day weekend, Friday, May 25th and Saturday, May 26th, 2013. For more information, please visit krishnadas.com.
What we're singing in India, they call the divine names, or the names of God. These are the names of our inner being, the presence that lives within us already as who we are, not as what we think we are in a worldly, daily kind of sense, but our actual true nature, which doesn't come and go and is always here. We're the ones that aren't here. So these practices are all designed to get us here by training us to release ourselves over and over and over and over and over again from the oppressive prison of thought, of the attachment and identification with our thoughts. Can you believe we actually think we're thinking most of the time? Who would have thought? But we do. And that is the definition of insanity. We actually believe everything we think. Can you imagine? We never question it. You wake up in the morning and go, I feel like shit today. You don't go, now wait a minute, do I really feel like shit? Or do I just think I feel like shit? We never question our thoughts. We think it, we believe it. This is really insanity. And everybody is just as crazy as we are. That's how come we can live together. We don't realize we are in the asylum. So the practice is viciously simple. And I mean that. You sing when you notice you're not paying attention. You're already back if you noticed you're not paying attention. Then you just begin to pay attention again to the singing that you're already doing. And most of the time, you'll begin to notice you're not paying attention. You know, you might be feeling, oh, this is so great. I feel so good. This is so good. I'm so happy to be here. And 2 hours will go by and you haven't been here for a minute. So, as soon as you notice you're not paying attention, just pay attention. You're going to notice that it happens a billion times a minute. And then you begin to think, well, where am I most of the time? God knows. But he ain't telling. He wants us to find out. So that's what we're doing. We're not trying to make any particular experience happen. If you don't feel good, that's okay. If you feel good, that's okay. If you don't feel either way, that's okay. Just come back to the singing. And that's the beauty of it, is that you can always let go of whatever you're thinking or feeling. You can always let go and come back to the singing. And this is what's required to find happiness, to find peace of mind. Peace of mind is not just having nice, pleasant little thoughts. Because where do they come from and where do they go? And what happens when the unpleasant thoughts come? Which they do. So it's not about that. Peace of mind is about residing in a place that's through which the thoughts pass, so to speak, which is here. So, you'll see. Eventually, we all see, but you know, it's a question of when. But whatever. So really, the practice is very simple. You sing. When you notice you're not paying attention, just come back. Don't spend any time thinking, oh, shit, I'm not paying attention. I spent 20 minutes. I haven't been here. Where have I been? What have I been doing? That's not paying attention. Come back. It doesn't matter what you think, because sooner or later, you're going to come back. So that's all you have to do. In the 800s, I believe, there was a great saint in India named Shankaracharya. One day he was walking down the street and he saw an old man sitting on the side of the road teaching the rules of Sanskrit grammar to a group of young students. Being a great saint, he could see that this old guy was going to die very soon, and that he hadn't done any spiritual work at all. He'd spent his whole life immersed in worldly stuff, external stuff. So out of compassion, he went up to him and he said, oh, my friend, Bhaja Govindam. Bhaja Govindam. Bhaja means to sing, to praise, to remember, or to immerse oneself. In this case, the name of Govinda. So that night he went home and he wrote a long hymn that he called Bhaja Govindam. And each verse looked out at our lives and described the many ways that we spend our time in dreamland, just completely unconscious, day after day. And then at the end of each verse he said, oh, my foolish mind or foolish heart, Bhaja Govindam. So a very powerful hymn. It's a beautiful, beautiful hymn. I always thought it would be nice to kind of update the images, to rewrite it with modern images and stuff, but I'm too lazy. It's too long. And only somebody like Shankaracharya could probably do it in the first place. So instead I wrote two new verses in English. And I'm going to sing them for you, and then we're going to sing Radhe Radhe Govinda, Bhaja Govinda.
Hello. Would you share a little about your recent visit with the Dalai Lama?
Nah.
Okay.
That was about it, actually. I've been to many, many, many teachings with His Holiness over the years, for many, many years now. And I've been in the same room with him many times, but I never actually met him. And so since I was going to be in Dharamsala, I thought, you know, he also was going to be there at the same time. So my friend who was organizing the kirtan there knows all the Tibetans, so she got me in waiting list online to have a personal meeting with him. I imagined, I didn't sleep the whole night before thinking, what am I going to say to him? I'm going to, you know, I'm going to go into his office. Why did I do this, you know? Why do I have to take up his time? He's got more important stuff to deal with than me, you know? Anyhow, so as it turned out, there was a whole group of Tibetans who had just come from Nepal, I think, or somewhere to see him. And there were a lot of people in line, and I was one of them, so the Tibetans were with him for a while, and then he walked, he was on his way from where he lives into the temple, so then he came into the temple, and somebody was ahead of me, came up to see him, talked to him for a few minutes, and then he left, and then, so I walked up, I said, Holiness, my name's Krishnadas. He goes, oh, Indian name. I said, yeah, and then blah, blah, blah. And then I handed him my CD, which I wanted to give him as a gift. Instead, he took it, he turned to the camera, held it like this, I turned, held it like this, camera took a picture, and he left. Leaving me with the CD, he didn't take it. But it was good. It was very nice. It was very sweet. But when it came down to it, I didn't have any questions. There was nothing I could ask him. I realized I shouldn't have even done it. But I did it anyhow, because I've always wanted to. So now I did that. I can relax for the rest of my life. He's got a great presence. He's an extraordinary being. Somebody once asked him, he said, Your Holiness, why does everybody love you so much? And he said, well, I said, I don't know. He said, but maybe it has something to do with the fact that I've spent my whole life caring about and considering the happiness of others. I'm going to repeat that. My whole life caring about and considering the happiness of others. If in a day I spend 1 minute thinking about somebody else other than myself, I'd have a goddamn heart attack. My whole life. This is all he is. He's only compassion and kindness and wisdom and caring. He doesn't have a personal agenda like, you know, I have to get happy first and then I could help other people. He's got it. He's become it completely. It's an incredible, it's inconceivable. All we can do is kind of like go, our minds can't compute what that means, because we are limited individuals. We all think we are who we think we are. So we're screwed right from the start. This is a being who doesn't think he's anything. There's no personal thing in there anymore. There's enough to, you know, eat, talk, do the things he has to do to survive. But there's nobody in there trying to get anything anymore and accumulate happiness and stuff. And there's no personal desires anymore. The planet of me has been obliterated in His Holiness. There's nothing for the stuff to orbit around anymore. He's one with the universe. You know, I didn't even like to say that. He's become what we all eventually will become, because we already are that. But he's recognized his true nature, which is the qualities of which are unbearable compassion for all beings. He doesn't have friends and enemies that he loves more than other people. He loves everybody with extraordinary intensity. I mean, there's people on a personal level that he hangs out with, that he's more friendly with, that he spends more time with. But on the other level, everybody's equal for him. And that doesn't mean it's like bland equal. It means it's like fantastic equal. Everybody he meets is full of, he sees bliss and happiness and Buddha. You know, it's almost like talking another language. You try to explain something, what something means in a language, and the person who doesn't speak that language goes, oh yeah, I got it. But they don't get it. And it's like that, you know. We can't really imagine, barely we can imagine what that state is like. And we can imagine it because we all long for that, all of us. We're all longing, searching for the same thing, which a being like His Holiness emanates and has become already.
I see that you sing in places like here, you know, peaceful place, the ashram. Have you been in a situation where you are singing and the area is in a conflict or it's not a peaceful place? And if, you know, have you been in a situation?
My house.
Oh, okay.
My mind.
Okay. Got it.
My life. Anything else?
All right. How about the neighbors?
No, I know what she's saying.
I'm curious about, you know, how you handle it or what happened.
Listen, when I sit down to sing, it's just the same thing every time. It doesn't really matter where I am. What's different might be the setting or the people who come Once I start singing, it's just the same thing. I don't sing differently for different people in different situations. I can't. This is what I do. I don't do anything else. So it's always the same. And the people are always the same, because everybody's very much the same, whether they're here or there or anywhere. One time we were in Utah, me and my friend John Friend, we were doing a workshop, a retreat up in the mountains, and there's a spot down nearby called the Parowan Gap, which is a gap in a ridge of mountains. And on a certain day every year, the sun goes right down the center of the gap, and there's a stone in the middle of this big field that was placed there by the ancient people. And on this day, that's the shadow of that stone, when the sun goes down, the shadow of that stone hits another stone. And so the ancients knew that was the day they could plant their crops. It's one of those things from, like a long time ago. So we used to go down there from the hills every, I think it's in June. I think the summer solstice beginning, something like that. And there was the people who were doing the retreat, we'd get together and we'd climb in the hills and then sing a little bit. And it was good. For the first few years, it was just us. And then the word started to get out among the locals that these weirdos were coming down from the mountains and singing. And so one day we arrived in, and there was like a big RV full of Mormons. It was like a family, like about 30 people, all these kids and everything. And I thought, oh, I see. And so I sang Amazing Grace and every hymn that I knew before we got to the figuring if I put them to sleep early, they could they'd leave us alone. But then there was also a pickup truck that pulled up around behind where we were singing, in the middle of the field with a gun rack and a few rifles. And I said to John, I said, maybe we shouldn't sing this week, this year, This guy's got rifles. Oh, KD, it'll be great. Let's just sing. Great. So we sang, and I have to admit, I couldn't get the pickup truck out of my mind, no matter what I was singing. I think Shree pickup truck, Jay pickup truck, Ram Ram pickup truck, pickup truck. So when I finished, I heard the door open and close of the pickup was behind us, right? So I we sat there, and this guy walks around in front of me, cowboy hat, boots, everything, looks down at me. I'm looking up, and I'm like, he said, "You Krishna Das?" But I still wasn't sure where this was going, you see. It's going to be a hitman from, I said, "Yeah." He said, "Boy, I love your music. I hear it on NPR out there on the range." I figure if I keep singing long enough, I'll be dead and this will all be over. You think I'm kidding? My strategy for any situation is to keep singing. Seriously, because there's nothing I could do that's better for myself. Nothing straightens my ass out, nothing gives me perspective, nothing quiets me down, nothing puts me in the right place to deal with anything more than chanting, period. So that's my solution to anything, or at least my strategy. It doesn't always work, but it's a strategy.